Good morning, church, and welcome to another virtual service. I know there's a lot of us that are missing just being able to go to our different church buildings or, you know, church locations. But, you know, God is still working through this situation, and I hope that we are still having fun, even with our virtual service, getting up from our seats, singing along, so that we're just glorifying God and listening to the message and just, you know, being impacted by God's word. So before we begin our service today, I just want us to go to God in a word of prayer. Our dear Heavenly Father, we just want to thank you, God, for another Sunday, Father God, where we can just be able to be joined, Father, even though it's over the internet, Father God. We pray that we may just feel your presence in each home, dear God, and that you may just continue, Father God, to just work in this situation. I know that a lot of people have lost loved ones, Father God. I know a lot of people are still going through this thing, Father God, and I pray that we may just be able to see your hand in this situation, dear God, that you may just be able to reveal what is the purpose of this situation, Father God, and that we may just grow out of it to just draw closer to you, dear God, and not to move away from you, dear God. Be with each part of the service today, Father God, that we may just have a great time as brothers and sisters, as friends and family, just have a great time worshiping you, dear God, and listening to your message. I want to pray all these things through your son's name, Jesus Christ, with thanksgiving in our hearts. Amen. Amen. So we're just immediately going to go into worshiping God in song, and our first song as we begin today is Healing Rain is Falling Down.
Thank you. church.
Thank you.
Good morning, brothers and sisters. This is the time we are going to take our communion right now. I pray that we are all ready and we have our bread and the grape of the vine that represents the blood and the body of our Lord Jesus Christ. This morning, I want us to focus on Jesus approaching Jericho when he met Zacchaeus. And we'll be looking at, we'll be taking up from the book of Luke chapter 19, verses 5 to 10. And the Bible reads, "When Jesus reached the spot, he looked up and said to Zacchaeus, and said to him, 'Zacchaeus, come down immediately. I must stay at your house today.' So he came down at once and welcomed him gladly. All the people saw this and began to mutter, 'He has gone to be a guest of a sinner.' But Zacchaeus stood up and said to the Lord, 'Look, Lord, here and now I give half of my possessions to the poor. And if I've cheated anybody of anything, I will pay back four times the amount.' Jesus said to him, 'Today salvation has come to this house, because this man too is the son of Abraham. For the Son of Man came to seek and save the lost.'" And I think this scripture, as I had it for my quiet time, and this week I really just focused on different conversion stories in the Bible. I looked at Peter, I looked at Saul, I looked at the eunuch. And when I met Mr. Zacchaeus in this book, I realized a few things. One, in all the stories that I've just mentioned, there's something that happens to these men when they have an encounter with Jesus or they have an encounter with God's word. And that is, they realize that there's something different about their lives and what they have experienced, and which is the truth. When Zacchaeus met Jesus, when he heard of him, he was curious, and I know that he was a wealthy man. You know, he had so many things going for him. But he realized, he said, wait, there should be much more to life than the money I have accumulated, than the wealth I have. And when Jesus says to him, he said, look, I must stay at your house today. Jesus walked into Jericho and he had a mission. He was focused on meeting Zacchaeus. When he met him, he didn't ask him to say, will I stay or may I stay? He says, I will stay at your house. I should be a guest in your house. And what did Zacchaeus do? He accepted. He welcomed Jesus into his house. And as they sat down to have a meal, I suppose, at that time, Zacchaeus decides to stand up and says, Lord, here and now, and to be very specific, he talks about himself. He says, here and now, not tomorrow, but here and now, I want to repent. These are the things that I have been doing. If I've cheated anybody, I want to give back four times as much. I actually want to give out half of my possessions. Now, if I really think about it, maybe he wasn't that rich. Maybe he was middle class. We don't know. But I would like to assume that he had some wealth to him. And when he says he would give back four times and give out half of his possession, I do believe that he was willing to let go of everything he had accumulated to possess this relationship with God, this salvation that had walked through his door. Jesus then says to him, salvation has come to this house because you too are a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man came to seek and save the lost. And that's what I mean. When Jesus approaches us, he has the mission in mind to reconcile us to God. In the Garden of Gethsemane, when Jesus was battling within himself whether or not he should take up the cross that was placed before him, he knew that to seek and save the lost, this mission of his was not going to be completed if he did not go ahead and die on the cross. Because Christianity, without the death and resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ, is faithless. It's based on nothing. We have the hope that one day when God comes, when he returns, when Jesus comes, everybody will be reunited with the Creator. But to be reunited, those that are dead have to be resurrected. And the one thing on this planet that Christians do hold on to is that we know that the very power that resurrected Christ from the dead is what's going to resurrect us too. And so in this moment, as we take our communion, I want us to just remember that, like, just like Zacchaeus, when he met Jesus, he realized that this man is the truth. He realized that this man brings more to life than the things that this world has to offer. Jesus said to him, Zacchaeus, you have met me, and I am the way. You have embraced me, and I am the truth. And what I offer you is salvation, because I am life. And like I said in the beginning, just remember, from the conversion stories, they all had an encounter with Jesus, and they all realize that he is the way, the truth, and the life. At this moment, I would like us to pray for both our communion and contribution. Let's pray. Our holy and righteous God, thank you so much for the love that you have for us, Father God, that is undying and never changing. Thank you so much for sending your Son to die on the cross for our sins. Thank you so much for him being focused, Father God, remembering us as he was here, Father God. How compassionate he was, Father God, attracted people to him, Father God. And I pray that every time we look into your word, we may see and we may be compelled to run towards the cross, Father God, to be strengthened by your Son's love for us, Father God. I want to pray for the contribution, Father God. I pray that you may help us to give wholeheartedly, Father God. I know that even as times may be hard, Father God, you are still our provider, Father God. And I pray that you may help us to show gratitude in our giving, Lord God Almighty. It's in the Son's name, Jesus Christ, I pray. Amen. Please do take note at this time that the information concerning our contribution, different accounts will be displayed on the screen, and just make sure that if you have any questions, please speak to your Bible Talk leaders. They'll be able to direct you from there on.
Good morning, everyone. Wherever you are watching us from, we just want to give you a very warm welcome. And wow, what a great morning it has already been. Thank you so much, praise and worship team, for a great, great job that you've done. And thank you so much, Henry, for reminding us, you know, about the cross of Jesus and what Jesus did for us on the cross. I just have a few announcements to the members of the church. You know, for the members of the church, we've been having a 70-day we're going through a 70-day prayer chain, and we're actually entering the fourth week. I hope it's been going great in the different groups and with whoever you've been praying together with as a prayer partner. And I hope it's just going great for you. And so if you're visiting with us and you don't know about this, please talk to the person who invited you so that you can actually join us, and so that we can continue to pray. We've been praying for what's going on in the rest of the world. We're praying to draw close to God. So please, you can join us and have a great time praying with us, okay? And again, just if you're joining us this morning, we want to take note of the contacts that are displayed on the screen so that you can actually keep in touch with us. You know, visit our website so that you can get, you know, the different details of who we are and what we do. And today is such an awesome day, you know, for all the mothers. You know, we want to say a very big, happy Mother's Day to all of you, and we have something special for you this morning. It's coming right away.
Happy Mother's Day, Mommy. You're the best mom ever. I love you.
Happy Mother's Day, Mommy. Thank you for everything. I love you so much.
Good day, Mommy. You're such a lovely, kind, and beautiful mom to us.
We love you, Mommy. God bless you, XOXO.
Happy Mother's Day. We love you and you're really special.
To all the mothers, and to give a special thanks to my mom. Mom, thank you for helping us. Thank you for loving us. Thank you for appreciating us. Thank you for comforting us. Thank you for praying for us. Thank you for being there for us. Thank you for supporting us every time. We appreciate you, Mom. We love you. Happy Mother's Day.
From the Ngosa family, we'd like to say a special thanks to our mom.
Mom, we love you.
Mom, we love you.
Happy Mother's Day.
Yeah, caring, sweet, and kind. Even if you are sad, I'll always be there to cheer you up.
Hi, Mommy. I wanted to say Happy Mother's Day. I have a poem for you. Roses are red, violets are blue. Sugar is sweet, and so are you. And there's another one. Roses are red, violets are blue. I asked for an angel and God gave me things.
Happy Mother's Day. I hope you enjoy it, and I hope that you have a nice time. Happy Mother's Day.
Happy Mother's Day, everyone, to all the mothers out there.
Hello, everyone. My name is Chimwemwe, and I'll be reading our poem for our mothers today. Dear Mom, your arms are always there when I need a hug. Your heart understands when I need a friend. Your gentle eyes are stern when I need a lesson. Your strength and love gives me wings to fly. I hope you know I appreciate all the things that you do. Love you so much, Mom. Happy Mother's Day to you. We love you.
Happy Mother's Day, and may God bless you. Thank you for caring for us and loving us. Have a happy Mother's Day.
Hi, Mom.
Happy Mother's Day.
Happy Mother's Day, Mom. Thank you for being our best friend. We just wanted to let you know how much we love you and appreciate you. Thank you so much for everything you've done for us and making us grow into these beautiful ladies. Happy Mother's Day to all the mothers in the church. We love you. Thank you. Stay blessed.
Amen, church. Today being Mother's Day, my sister Chipo and I thought to encourage our mothers in a dear way. So my sister Chipo read a few scriptures and a few words of encouragement, and I just hope you'll be encouraged by the words.
Amen. Our first reading is coming from Isaiah 49:15, and it says, can a mother forget her nursing child? Can she feel no love for the child she has born? Isaiah 66:13 says, "As one whom his mother comforts, so I will comfort you." Proverbs 31:25-31 says, "She is clothed with strength and dignity. She can laugh at the days to come. She opens her mouth with wisdom, and the teaching of kindness is on her tongue. Her children rise up and call her blessed, her husband also, and he praises her. Many women have done excellently, but he surpasses them all. Honor her for all that her hands have done, and her works bring her praise at the city gates."
Amen. Very, very encouraging words. I hope our mothers have been encouraged by scripture. And yeah, so I have a song for you, my dear mothers, and I hope you're going to be encouraged by it. That's Song for Mama by Boyz II Men.
You told me everything, and everything you give me, I always keep it inside. You're the driving force in my life. There isn't anything or anyone that I can be. It just wouldn't feel right. And if I didn't have you by my side, oh, you were there for me, you loved and cared for me when skies were gray. Whenever I was down, you were always there to comfort me. And no one else can be what you've been to me. You will always be. You will always be the girl in my life for all times. Mama, mama, you know that I love you. You know I love you, mama. Mama, you're the queen of my heart. And you're the stars, oh yes it is, mama. I just want you to know, loving you is like food to my soul. Yes it is, yes it is. You've always done for me, you've always been around for me, even when I was blind. You gave me the strength to go. You did, and you took up for me when everyone was doubting me. You always did understand. You gave me strength to go on. There was so many times looking back when I was so afraid, and then you'd comfort me and say to me I could face anything. And no one else can be what you've done for me. You will always be, you will always be the girl in my life for all time. Cause mama, mama, you know that I love you. You know I love you, mama. And your love is like tears from the stars. Oh, yes it is. Mama, I just want you to know. Loving you is like food to my soul.
Good morning, family, friends, and anyone who's joining us for our Sunday service this morning. It truly is a special Sunday as we think of all the mothers that are being celebrated all over the world. Happy Mother's Day to you, and I hope in some sort of way you have been told how special, how dear, and how appreciated you are as mothers to us in just the different ways that you help our lives become better. You add color to our lives. This morning, I'm going to be taking us through our sermon for today. And the title of my message this morning is The Mission. So, I don't know about you, but what comes to mind when you hear the word mission? You know, different things may come to mind. Maybe even right now as I say that, different things may be popping into your mind. But I know for myself, when I hear the word mission, what comes to mind is some of my favorite mission movies out there. You know, I think of Mission Impossible. I think of, you know, when it comes to mission, I think of, you know, an agent, there's bad guys, there's gadgets, there's cars, you know, and there's all these great things happening for the good guy to be able to achieve this great task that he has to do in the movie. And as we talk about missions, about what is the mission this morning, I want to be able to start off by reading a short story to you from a book I've been digging into over the past weeks. This is a book called Start With Why by Simon Sinek. And in here, he's basically talking about how we need to start with why are we doing what we're doing. And I think this is very vital when it comes to thinking about our mission as Christians or as disciples of Jesus Christ. And I want to read you this short story to kind of add to what I'm going to be speaking to you about this morning. So if you would listen with me. It says, the goal was ambitious. Public interest was high. Experts were eager to contribute. Money was readily available. Armed with every ingredient for success, Samuel Pierpont Langley set out in the early 1900s to be the first man to pilot an airplane. Highly regarded, he was a senior officer at the Smithsonian Institution and mathematics professor who had also worked at Harvard. His friends included some of the most powerful men in government and business, including Andrew Carnegie and Alexander Graham Bell. Langley was given a $50,000 grant from the War Department to fund his project, a tremendous amount of money for the time. He put together the best minds of the day, a veritable dream team of talent and know-how. Langley and his team used the finest materials, and the press followed him everywhere. People all over the country were riveted to the story, waiting to read that he had achieved his goal. With the team he had gathered and ample resources, his success was guaranteed. Or was it? A few hundred miles away, Wilbur and Orville Wright were working on their own flying machine. Their passion to fly was so intense that it inspired the enthusiasm and commitment of a dedicated group in their hometown, Daytona, Ohio. There was no funding for their venture, no government grants, no high-level connections. Not a single person on the team had an advanced degree or even a college education. Not even Wilbur or Orville. But the team banded together in a humble bicycle shop and made their vision real. On December 17th, 1903, a small group witnessed a man take flight for the first time in history. How did the Wright brothers succeed where a better equipped, better funded, and better educated team could not? It wasn't luck. Both the Wright brothers and Langley were highly motivated. Both had strong work ethic. Both had keen scientific minds. They were pursuing exactly the same goal. But only the Wright brothers were able to inspire those around them and truly lead their team to develop a technology that would change the world. Only the Wright brothers started with why. And I share that story because I believe that story has some great ingredients to help you and I focus on the mission. You know, part of something I learned during this week was through a class that I take, you know, in our churches. We're doing a class online, basically a ministry training. It's called Ministry Training Academy. And one of the brothers who teaches there, Neil Trollope, he leads our church in Port Elizabeth, was talking about basically vision and mission and how the organization he used to work for, you know, one of the things he'll do is they'll come up with the mission and the vision for the organization. And he talked about this one time when they were struggling to come up with that. And one of his colleagues said, why don't we start off by looking at one of our key stakeholders, or basically one of our key clients, looking at what they do, and then maybe we can derive a mission and a vision for what we are supposed to be doing. He said when they did this, they were able to achieve their task. You know, and a lot of us, when we think of the word mission, what is our mission as a Christian? What is my mission as a disciple of Jesus Christ? A lot of times we can scratch our heads and we can fumble about it because maybe we're not starting with God and Jesus and asking the question, what is God's mission for his Christians? What is God's mission for his disciples? You know, because the Bible does make it clear that God and Jesus already have a vision. They already have a mission for the church. They already have a mission and a vision for each and every Christian and each and every disciple of Jesus Christ. And one thing that Neil also talked about was that God also already has a church for his mission. God already has disciples, you know, for his vision. You know, I think of how Jesus talks about that, you know, no one can come to the Father unless the Father calls them. So once we start with that in mind, we'll be able to define what we are supposed to be doing on the mission that Jesus has called us to. And before we even get into the scripture for the day, I want us to look at some definitions that I was thinking through as I was coming to this sermon. You know, Neil was teaching us in the lesson that he was taking us through that, you know, vision is what the future will look like, which serves to focus and inspire you and I. A mission is what you and I would do to achieve the vision, which is connected to you and my purpose. So this morning, I want you to keep those two definitions in mind as we read this, the next couple of verses from Luke chapter 4. So if you turn with me to Luke chapter 4. In Luke chapter 4, the Bible starts off in verse 1 by saying, Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, left the Jordan and was led by the Spirit into the wilderness, where for 40 days he was tempted by the devil. He ate nothing during those days. And at the end of them, he was hungry. The devil said to him, if you are the Son of God, tell the stone to become bread. Jesus answered, it is written, man shall not live on bread alone. The devil led him up to a high place and showed him in an instant all the kingdoms of the world. And he said to him, I will give you all their authority and splendor. It has been given to me, and I can give it to anyone I want. If you worship me, it will all be yours. Jesus answered, it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve him only. The devil led him to Jerusalem and had him stand on the highest point of the temple. If you are the Son of God, he said, throw yourself down from here. For it is written, he will command his angels concerning you to guard you carefully. They will lift up their hands so that you will not strike a foot against a stone. Jesus answered, it is said, do not put the Lord your God to the test. When the devil had finished all this tempting, he left him until an opportune time. Jesus returned to Galilee in the power of the Spirit, and news about him spread through the whole countryside. He was teaching in their synagogues, and everyone praised him. He went to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, and on the Sabbath day, he went into the synagogue, as was his custom. He stood up to read. The scroll of the prophet Isaiah was handed to him, and rolling it, he found the place where it is written, the Spirit of the Lord is on me, because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners and recovery of sight for the blind, to set the oppressed free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. Then he rolled up the scroll, gave it back to the attendant, and sat down. The eyes of everyone in the synagogue were fastened on him. He began by saying to them, today this scripture is fulfilled in your hearing. All spoke well of him and were amazed at the gracious words that came from his lips. Isn't this Joseph's son? They asked. Jesus said to them, surely you will quote this proverb to me. Physician, heal yourself. And you will tell me, do here in your hometown what we heard that you did in Capernaum. Truly I tell you, he continued, no prophet is accepted in his hometown. I assure you that there were many widows in Israel in Elijah's time when the sky was shut for 3.5 years and there was a severe famine throughout the land. Yet Elijah was not sent to any of them, but to a widow in Zarephath, in the region of Sidon. And there were many in Israel with leprosy in the time of Elisha the prophet. Yet not one of them was cleansed, only Naaman the Syrian. What an amazing passage. This is one of my favorite passages in the Bible. And I believe this passage helps you and I know what God's mission, what Jesus' mission is for you and I. And today, I want us to be able to look at two things that will help us realize whether we are on the mission that God has for us or we are distracted from the mission. You know, the first thing I'm going to speak about is that the bad guy. Remember, I talked about my favorite movies and how there's always a bad guy when it's involving a mission? And here, similarly, we have a bad guy in this mission. So the bad guy and others can derail you and I from our mission. You know, let's dig into this first point and see what we can pick up. You know, when we begin reading this chapter, we start off with the famous passage of Jesus being tempted in the wilderness by the devil as he gets ready to focus intensely on his mission for the next 3 years. We see that the devil tests Jesus in three ways during this time. The first is by testing his hunger and, you know, saying, man, you know, since you're so hungry, why don't you turn these stones into bread and satisfy that hunger? The second way the devil tempts him is by testing his desire to accumulate power and wealth. He offers him the kingdoms and the wealth and the authority of the world. He says, these have been handed to me. I can give them to you in an instant only if you worship me. The third thing we see is he tests him by asking him to question his security, asking him to question his knowledge and understanding of how much he knows that God loves him as his son. You know, we see in all these three instances that Jesus knew his mission and would not allow the devil to tempt him, because those temptations would distract him from the mission that God had for him. You know, in order to do this, Jesus knew his mission brief. Or shall I say it in another way? Jesus knew his mission's instruction. You know, if you've ever watched, like I was mentioning in the beginning, the Mission Impossible movies, you always notice how Tom Cruise would get his instructions from his superiors. And he would listen to them and commit them to memory. And within a moment, there would always be a message saying, you know, this message would self-destruct, you know, in so many seconds. And Tom Cruise would have to commit that mission, the mission instructions, to memory as he goes about achieving his mission. You know, Jesus is way better than Tom Cruise because he knew the whole Bible. He was able to quote and counter the devil with scriptures as the devil tried to distract him from his mission. Jesus knew his mission instructions each moment the devil tried to tempt him and would always respond, "It is written." For those of us who are on the mission, those of us who claim to be Christians, who claim to be disciples of Jesus Christ, do you and I know our mission instructions? Do we know them enough to make sure that whenever the devil comes our way to tempt us, to get off track, to derail us from the mission, we are able to say, oh, wait a minute, it is written. This is not part of my mission instructions. So this is going to waste my time. It's going to take my attention away from what God wants me to do. Because remember, even with Jesus, the scripture says the devil waited for an opportune time. So the devil didn't just stop there on those first three attempts. He was always looking for a way to derail Jesus off the mission that he had to come and die on the cross for you and I. And it's the same for you and I today. If the devil was going to do that with our Lord and Savior, what makes you think that he is not on a mission himself to derail you and I from the mission that God has given us? And you know what? Today, the devil still uses the same temptations. You know, today, the devil will lie to you and I by saying, I know how I can direct the hunger that you have to something that might satisfy it. This morning, what hunger is the devil trying to get you to focus on so that you don't focus on the mission? What things are you craving? What things are you desiring that the devil is saying, you know what, just do this and you will be satisfied. That hunger will be taken away. You know, brothers and sisters, if you and I are not aware to that, we'll go about trying to satisfy those cravings, those hungers, only in vain. Because as we know, Jesus told the Samaritan woman that, you know what, he is the bread of life. He is the water that quenches whatever it is that we're thirsting for or hungering for. So this morning, are you distracted from the mission because the devil is trying to get you to turn stone into bread so you can feed your hunger? You know, the devil will also lie to us that, man, if you and I just focus on building our careers, you know, building the amount of authority we have, you know, amassing all the power we can, you know, if we just focus on building these great kingdoms, we might be fulfilled through that. And how many of us today are caught up in the rat race of amassing wealth, of being like the rich fool in the Bible who says, man, you know, he amassed all this wealth, he built all these big barns, and he says, you know what, I'm going to put my feet up and say, you have done well. And God says, you fool, today your very life will be demanded of you. You know, brothers and sisters, if you and I were to amass all the authority, all the power, and all the kingdoms in the world, that still would not satisfy us. That is not your mission and my mission on this earth. That's not the mission that God has for you and I. So this morning, you and I need to ask ourselves the hard questions. Are we more invested in amassing power, amassing wealth, amassing authorities, building up whatever our kingdoms look like in our minds, than we are in building up the kingdom of God? Than we are in storing up treasures in heaven and not treasures on earth? Than we are in making sure that God's power and God's authority is seen clearly in the world through us? You know, finally, the devil will try and get you and I to doubt, to test our security in God's love for you and I as his children. You know, and what I've learned from my experience is that mostly this comes when you and I are going through suffering, trials, or tribulations. Aren't those the hardest times where you feel like, God, where are you? If I am your son, if I am your daughter, why would I be going through this? And the devil says, you know what? Yeah, if you are truly the son of God, if you're truly the daughter of God, why are you going through such a hard time? Maybe you've sinned. Maybe God doesn't really see you. The devil will try and trick you and I to say, you know what? Test God. And Jesus says, do not put the Lord your God to the test. He's already done the ultimate thing of sending Jesus Christ to die on the cross for you and I. He says, no greater love than this. So do you and I have security in that? That we'll be content to know that God loves us enough to want to reconcile him, reconcile you and I back to himself at whatever cost. If not, you and I will go about trying to test our security in God through different ways and forget the mission that God has given you and I. Because God has already proven that you and I are worth everything to him. So we don't need to test that. We just need to focus on the mission that he has given us. You know, brothers and sisters, Jesus gave us an example of how to stay focused when temptations come our way. Do you want to know how to stay focused this morning on the mission? Know your mission instructions. Because if not, the devil will try and get you off your mission. You know, the second thing I see on this point of how the bad guy and people close to us or people around us can derail us from our mission is in verse 22 to 27, it says, you know, the people were amazed when Jesus talked about his mission. But then in verses 18 to 19, it says, they quickly started doubting him and they said, isn't this Joseph's son? You know, people will doubt you and I when you and I are invested in the mission that God has given us. When you and I are so clear on the mission, people would ask and say, but aren't you the guy who used to be like this? Aren't you the guy who used to be a drunkard, who used to be a sex addict, who used to be a drug addict? And they'll look back at that and say, how can you be so focused on the mission of God? Brothers and sisters, don't let that derail you because you are now new in Christ. You know, again, the other thing we see here is that, man, all these people were actually just interested in the interesting parts of, you know, being together with Jesus. They wanted a buffet-style served Christianity where they can pick and choose only the parts that they were interested in. They wanted the flashy lights. They wanted the fireworks. They wanted the miracles that Jesus was doing. And they said, man, do for us what you were doing in Capernaum. They weren't interested in him being, you know, able to set the oppressed free. They just wanted the miracles. You know, Jesus quickly tackles this head on and says in verse 24 to 25, saying that, you know what, even the prophets, Elijah and Elisha, man, they had many other needs during their time, during their mission that God had given them. But it says Elijah was focused on that one widow in Zarephath during that whole time. Elisha was focused on Naaman. It says there were many other needs, but they focused on the need that God had called them to meet. And guess what their reaction was? It says, all the people in the synagogue were furious when they heard this. That's in verse 28 of chapter 4. How many times have you and I encountered this? Where people want you and I to focus on their needs or wants at the expense of you and I focusing on the mission that God has for us. Isn't this why Jesus challenges us in Luke 14 verse 25 to 26 saying, you know, large crowds were traveling with Jesus, and turning to them he said, if anyone comes to me and does not hate father, mother, wife, children, brothers and sisters, yes, even their own life, such a person cannot be my disciple. Basically saying such a person cannot enroll into the mission that I have for people that will want to follow me. You know, as important as the people who are around us are, as important as those who are closest to us are, as important as their needs and wants are, all these things come secondary to the mission of following Jesus and partnering with him on the mission that he came to accomplish. So this morning, are you focused or are you derailed from the mission that God has for you and I? So my second and final point is, are you and I in step with Jesus' mission? You know, in Luke chapter 4, verse 18 to 19, it says, the Spirit of the Lord is on me because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners and recovery of sight for the blind, to set the oppressed free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. This was and is Jesus' mission. Is it yours and mine this morning? You know, I'd like to walk through these different parts of the mission. But before I do that, remember the story I read to you in the beginning of the race to create the first airplane. And in that, we see that those two groups were not equally funded. One group had all the money, all the brains, all the talent. The other group didn't have that. Well, I have some good news for you and I this morning. The good news is that you and I, on the mission that Jesus has called us to, are all equally funded. We're all equally equipped to sign up for this mission. Because he says, the Spirit of the Lord is on me. Similarly, when you and I get baptized, it says we receive the Spirit. And the Spirit empowers you and I to achieve the mission that God has for you and I. The Spirit gives us everything we need to accomplish the mission that Jesus wants you and I to accomplish. You know, just like we see in the great movies of missions, like I told you about in the beginning, how, you know, the agent always has an earpiece and there's someone in the earpiece kind of directing them, telling them about what's coming on ahead. The Holy Spirit plays the same role. He plays an even bigger role than just directing us. Jesus says he's a comforter. He prays for us even when we can't pray for ourselves. He says the Holy Spirit is on him and has anointed him. The Holy Spirit is on you and I, and has anointed us for the mission that God has for you and I this morning. We have the best ever support that any agent can need on a mission. Are you in tune with the Holy Spirit? You know, the other thing we see in this mission is that Jesus says he's been sent to proclaim good news to the poor. He's been sent to proclaim freedom for the prisoners, recovery of sight for the blind, and to set the oppressed free. You know, this is a vital part of our mission. This is a vital part of the instructions that God has given us. Are you and I proclaiming good news to the poor through our service to them by washing their feet, just as Jesus showed us? Do we see the different types of poverty around us? Not just the physical poverty, the emotional, the spiritual. You can name it. Do you see the different types of poverty that people are grappling with around you? It says, freedom from the prisoners. Are you and I engaged in this? You know, You and I, before we started walking with Jesus, we were prey also prisoners to many other things, prisoners to sin. And Jesus has set you and I free. He's paid the price. His blood cleanses us from that. But he says it doesn't just stop there. Just as you are free now, we are also called to help direct others to him so that they can find true freedom in him. Recovery of sight for the blind and set the oppressed free. Are you involved in helping people who are so blind to the truth? Are you involved in helping people who are being oppressed in so many ways? Even just during this time of the COVID pandemic, one of the things I was listening to is how, man, the cases of abuse at home have probably gone up, especially with the girl child and people being at home all the time. Are you involved in setting the oppressed free? Are you involved in setting those who have been blinded and oppressed by sin free? And what does that look like for you today? You know, he says, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. You know, one of the things that we can think about is, especially in the year 2020, we can feel like, man, the year has gone to waste because, you know, the whole COVID pandemic has kind of spoiled our plans. But do you believe that this is still the year of the Lord's favor? And are you helping bring hope to people by still proclaiming that as a disciple of Jesus Christ, as a Christian, saying, you know what, even if it seems like everything is falling apart, know this, God is still on the throne. And it's still the year of the Lord's favor. Brothers and sisters, that is our Lord's mission. That is yours and my mission. So how do you understand the mission this morning? What parts of the mission are you strong in? What parts are you needing to grow in? We all have a part that we need to grow in. We all have a part that we're doing well in. But I believe this morning, if we are truly focused about being the best agents we can be for Jesus Christ, about being the best disciples of Jesus Christ that we can be, about being the best Christians that we can be, we have to be engaged in the mission. And we have to be aware that we're not being derailed by the devil and his temptations. We have to be aware that people around us are not derailing us from the mission because of other things that do not fall in line with God's will. And above all, we have to remember that Jesus already has a mission. We don't need to scratch our heads about what this mission needs to be. We need to go to this mission that he talks about in Luke chapter 4, 18 to 19. Take it line by line and say, how am I doing in these different parts of the mission? But above all, we need to be comforted that we are all equally equipped, all equally funded, because the Spirit waits to assist us through our mission. So this morning, I hope in a small way, you have been able to just look at your own life, as I have been able to look at my life through the week in preparing this message, in just asking myself, am I focused on the mission that God has for me? Have a great Sunday, and God bless.
Wow, 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 wow. What an awesome message that has been. Thank you so much, Twambo, for just reminding us that we are on a mission and just reminding us of what we need to do so that we can bring glory to God's name. At this point, I don't want to add anything. Let's go to God in prayer as we close out our service this morning. Father in heaven, thank you so much for the great God that you are and the great King that you are. Thank you so much, Lord of all lords, just for giving us life. Thank you so much, Father, for sending your one and only Son, Jesus Christ, to die on the cross so that we could be able to be a family, God. And thank you so much for everybody this morning who has joined us, Father God, Lord, as we worship you, God, and as we praise you, Father. Thank you for every event, Father God, this morning. It's been so encouraging and so inspiring. And as we start the week, Lord, we pray that you'll begin with us, oh God, that you'll walk with us, oh Father, that we'll be about your business, King of all kings, and not just the things of this world, Almighty God. We want to continue to bring to you, Lord God, those who are suffering as a result of the pandemic that is ravaging the world at this point, oh Father. We have those that are in hospitals and they are in great pain. Father, please, God, comfort them, oh God. Encourage them in your own ways, oh Father in heaven. Heal those who are sick, Lord in heaven. I know that those that are bereaved at this point as a result of this pandemic and maybe as a result of many other situations, could be accidents, oh Lord Almighty. I beg you once again, Lord, that you will comfort them, oh God, of all God. Lord. Father, and we continue to pray, Father. We continue to pray for a vaccine so that, Father, this COVID-19 can actually be brought to its knees, O King of all kings. So, Father, we love you, God. We pray that, God, you continue to be with us. Be with the rest of the week, Father, as we serve you. We exalt you, God, and we thank you for everything. It is in Jesus' mighty name that we do pray all these things. God bless you. Amen.